Thank you, Peter. Thanks, everybody, for coming. As Peter mentioned, the Federal Defend Trade Secrets Act is a fairly new piece of legislation. It went into effect last May, signed by President Obama, and I have not heard any repeal or replace language from the new administration, so I think it's going to stick around. What the Federal Defend Trade Secrets Act does is it creates a uniform federal cause of action for misappropriation of trade secrets. As Peter mentioned before, prior to this law, there really wasn't a federal statute that a company could use to enforce trade secrets nationwide. It would have to go state by state, pretty much. And even though the state laws are pretty similar, as Peter mentioned, Ohio's version of the Ohio's Trade Secrets Act is derived from the Uniform Trade Secrets Act, which I believe 48 states have adopted. But a state court, if you get injunctive relief or you get some sort of relief, that state's power to restrict or enjoin somebody from misappropriating trade secrets is not going to be enforceable outside that particular state. So with the extent of interstate commerce that we have right now, the Federal Trade Secrets Act provides a mechanism where you could go into federal court and get injunctive relief nationwide. I mean, just like with what happened with the Trump travel ban, that federal court in Washington didn't just ban that travel ban in the state of Washington or Minnesota. It was nationwide. And the Federal Defend Trade Secrets Act, if you go into a federal court and get that injunctive relief, it wouldn't just apply to the state that you're in. It would apply nationwide. So that's the appeal of the Federal Defend Trade Secrets Act. The definition of trade secrets in the federal statute is very similar to what Peter read in the Ohio statute, which is part of the Uniform Trade Secrets Act. There's a 3-year statute of limitations under the federal statute. And like I mentioned before, the big advantage is that you can get nationwide relief as opposed to state-by-state relief. And I mentioned here, avoid differences in state law. The definitions are the same. Most of the law in trade secrets has been established through common law, the court's interpretation of what constitutes a trade secret, what constitutes reasonable measures to maintain its secrecy. And those will not only vary state by state, but they can vary by different courts within a state. You'll see when we get to what Franklin County said in that case that Peter mentioned about the memorizing trade list was different than what Cuyahoga County said. And ultimately, the Supreme Court was the arbiter and established the standard. Now, when I looked in preparing for this, how often this statute has been utilized, it really hasn't. I read something the other day that said there were only 31 pending cases of involving the Federal Trade Secrets Act, which I thought was astonishingly low. I know it's pretty new, but we'll see if it's used more frequently, and I suspect it will, and the case law will be developed as a federal body of case law as opposed to the state law. Now, one thing that it doesn't do, a lot of times federal law preempts state law. The Federal Defend Trade Secrets Act doesn't preempt any state law claims or remedies. You could file a lawsuit under the Federal Defend Trade Secrets Act and the State Trade Secrets Act. You can also file claims for breach of contract, breach of a non-competition covenant, breach of a confidentiality or non-disclosure agreement, tortious interference with business relationships. You could combine all of those claims together. You aren't shoehorned into that one new federal law. And in fact, federal courts have what is called supplemental jurisdiction over the state claim. So if you have a federal cause of action under the Federal Defend Trade Secrets Act, you could also bring your state claims in that federal court. The Defend Trade Secrets Act does offer the traditional remedies available. Injunctive relief, which I assume most of you know what that means. That means the court isn't awarding money damages. It is basically preventing, by court order, somebody from using or disclosing a trade secret. There's preliminary or temporary injunctive relief, and oftentimes these cases will end up in an order of permanent injunction where you can't ever use or misappropriate that confidential information or trade secret. You can get compensatory damages, and oftentimes these cases involve you're trying to prevent somebody from damaging you in the future, and you're also trying to recover damages for what they've done up to that point in time. It's not either or, you oftentimes go for both. I will tell you, and I mentioned when we were just networking a little bit and talking before the performance, my experience is the damages part can be, it might be easy to prove, but practically it could be it could be difficult for your business and actually detrimental to your business, because think about customers. If one of your employees leaves your employ, goes to a competitor and starts selling to that customer, you're going to say, well, that's my customer. He sold those products. I want that order and the profits from that order to be awarded to me. Well, how are you going to go prove that in a court? You're going to have to show that but for that person going out, working for the new company, the competitor, and getting that order, you would have received that order and you would have made that profit. Which means, more likely than not, bringing that company into court, taking depositions, and coming into court to testify. And I can tell you, and you guys could probably imagine if you were in that situation, the last thing you want to do is get into a peeing contest between one competitor and another competitor. What I've seen, and Peter and I had this in a case that we had recently, a lot of times these customers will say, I don't want to do business with either of you. I'm not going to deal with old company. I'm not going to deal with new company. I'll go to the third company over here. So compensatory damages are available, but pragmatically sometimes it's a be careful what you wish for.
You can get exemplary or
punitive damages under the Federal Trade Secret Act, Defend Trade Secret Act. It is limited to twice the amount of compensatory damages. You could also get attorney's fees. It's actually written in the statute, which a lot of times in litigation, it becomes almost the biggest issue because litigation is so expensive that you're oftentimes not made whole if you get your recovery. You not only want the relief that you are entitled to, but you want the other side to pay for your lawyer. Under the Defend Trade Secret Act, if you show that this misappropriation was willful and wanted, basically that they did it on purpose and intentionally and really with some bad act, you can recover attorney's fees. Now, the attorney fee provision works both ways. If somebody is sued for misappropriation of a trade secret and they can show that that claim was brought in bad faith or that they wanted to terminate an injunction that was opposed, the defendant can have the plaintiff pay for its attorney's fees. One thing that the Defend Trade Secret Act has that is different than most of the state statutes is, in addition to injunctive relief, they have a civil seizure remedy. It hasn't been tested based on my research all that much, but what it says is, if injunctive relief isn't going to adequately protect you, that, let me step back for a second. Generally, when you go to enjoin somebody or restrict somebody, you go into a court and file a motion for a temporary restraining order, you have to give notice to the other side. A lot of times when you give that notice, they're getting rid of the goods. They're eating their homework. They're flushing it down the toilet. Under the federal statute,
if you could show through extraordinary circumstances, and the case law really hasn't been developed to definitively determine what extraordinary circumstances is, where a TRO would be inadequate to help you, you can actually have the U.S. Marshals go out and seize what they stole. And again, the standard is you must show that the defendant would destroy, move, hide, or otherwise make such matter inaccessible to the court if the applicant were to proceed unnoticed to such person.
Again, it hasn't, there's not an extensive body of case law out there that showed it's been tested, but it is a significant difference in the federal statute versus what Ohio's Trade Secret Act and the other state acts show. There's one other significant difference in the Defend Trade Secret Act from the State Act. And again, there's not a lot of case law development on it, but there is a requirement in employment agreements and confidentiality agreements that you actually provide notice of what they call whistleblower immunity. And what that is, what you're basically saying is to your employees that you have a privilege to use or disclose trade secret information if you are doing it to report or investigate a suspected violation of the law. And there's actually language that there's no magic language, but you basically have to tell the employee that they have the right to do this. They're not going to be subject to liability under the Defend Trade Secret Act if they are using or disclosing a trade secret for whistleblower purposes. Now, what happens if a company doesn't have that notice of whistleblower immunity in its agreements? And I'm sure you could talk to our labor people. There's some here that would help you put those provisions in your agreements. But what the statute says that if you are suing an employee that doesn't have that language in either an employment agreement or a confidentiality agreement, you lose your right to cover punitive damages or attorney's fees. Now, in thinking about this, I was thinking about, well, what if you don't have employment agreements or confidentiality agreements? Is there still that whistleblower protection and immunity? And the case law really hasn't answered that question yet, but I think most people do have confidentiality agreements and employment agreements, so it is important to put this notice of whistleblower immunity in there if you want to be able to potentially assert claims against any bad boy or bad girl employee down the road and be able to potentially recover punitive damages and attorney's fees. That is essentially the Defend Trade Secrets Act in a nutshell. Like Peter said, we're going to spend the did someone have a question? I'm sorry. And feel free to ask any question. Yes, sir. Well, the three-year period is the statute of limitations for bringing the claim. That's not necessarily the time limit of protection. So if you have an employee that goes to a competitor and uses customer lists or price lists, you would have 3 years under the statute from the acts of misappropriation to bring suit. A court would still be free to fashion any remedy from a specific period of time. Most of the time, injunctions in trade secret cases are permanent. That's the difference between a breach of contract for a non-compete or a non-disclosure. They typically have time frames. They'll say you can't contact former customers that you dealt with for a period of 3 years. Once that 3 year period is over, that employee would be free to contact those customers. But if it's a misappropriation of a trade secret, oftentimes the injunction is permanent. You can't ever use it.
So is this discovery after 3 years? I'm not clear on this. The discovery of the problem is after 3 years. What happens?
Well, there is the
statute of limitations generally start to run from the time the cause of action accrued. So usually that means when the bad acts occurred. But there is what's called the discovery rule for statute of limitations purposes, that if you discover something, say 4 years after the fact, but it is not reasonable for you to have determined it prior, that the discovery of the bad act is actually what triggers the start of the statute of limitations. So you're not necessarily barred by 3 years from the act. Oftentimes, I do a lot of construction litigation, and you have latent defects. A lot of times, even though the defect is there, you don't discover it until years later. That's what starts. When you reasonably should have discovered the problem is when the statute of limitations start, and that concept is equally applicable in misappropriation of trade secret cases.
Ryan, it's probably worth mentioning, too, in answer to that question, that the Federal Defend Trade Secrets Act is so new, there's really no case law yet on it. We would anticipate there would be a discovery rule applicable to that 3-year statute of limitation. One thing to keep in mind, though, we didn't mention this, trade secrets have no termination date. They're forever, as opposed to like a patent that has a limitation. The patent by its nature is publicly disclosed. The owner of the patent has a monopoly basically for a period of time. Once the patent has expired, it's in the public domain and it's been fully disclosed. Pardon me? No, patents are, I think, I believe 20 years. So patents have a limited life. A trade secret, there are some companies here in town I know of that prefer trade secrets over patents just for that reason. They don't have to disclose it. They don't have to go through the expensive process of obtaining a patent. And as long as they, Lincoln Electric, for example, is known to have many trade secrets in their welding areas, and those trade secrets could go to date back 30, 40, 50 years. And as long as they maintain, they do what they need to do to maintain them as trade secrets, there's no time limit.
You know, it was interesting when Peter asked the question, is how many of you believe that your business has trade secrets? And I think there was a vast majority, but not everybody. I would submit that if you actually thought about it, everybody has trade secrets, whether you realize it or not, because you can think of something that is beneficial to you economically because you know it and other people in your business don't. I mean, it could be something as simple as price lists, customer lists, to something more extensive as formulas for product. The other thing, as Peter mentioned, it's pretty easy to establish that first element of a trade secret because for reasons I just said, you could think of many things that are more valuable because you know it and your competitors don't. Where the rubber meets the road and where the issues in litigation come up is, what have you done to protect the secrecy of that trade secret? Have you taken the reasonable measures to maintain the confidential nature of that information? And what we're going to do now is talk about some case law examples and some real life examples that we have where we've really tested those issues in court. If you want to talk, yeah. and then I can jump in.
From my perspective, what I want to share with you, and you know, you've heard sort of in the abstract how this works, but this is a case I had, and I, from my perspective, I'll never have another comparable trade secrets case. To me, this is the mother of all trade secrets cases. So here's what's happened, and this is all true. I will not name the actual parties. I received a phone call from the president of the company, and he said, "We're not sure what's going on here, but one of my engineers came in. This company is a large employer in Portage County, manufactures an industrial product, and they're worldwide, not just in the United States. They actually have a plant in China. This product is in Europe, United States,
China,
the Middle East, Australia, everywhere." So engineer comes in with the Talmadge Gazette or something like that, and it had an advertisement or a little article about a new business that was going to be opening, and by the name of it, my client knew that this was a competitor of theirs out of South Africa that had never been in the United States before. So when the engineer brought it in, he said,
call the reporter and see if you can get more information about where they're, you know, they're going to be opening up in Summit County. That seems awfully strange. So the engineer called the reporter, and he said, we're interested in getting more information. Can you tell me, you know, where I can get more information? He said, well, I can tell you my source. My information came from a guy named Jack So-and-so. Well, Jack So-and-so was my client's manager of special projects, which is why the president of the company called me to say, how can this be? So that was, I think, on a Wednesday. At the time, Jack So-and-so was at a trade show, I believe, in Dallas. And what we set up was Monday when he came back in, unaware, and this is, he had a six-figure salary, company car, reported directly to the president, but was really kind of autonomous. He would travel around and develop, do some marketing. I had a computer forensics person with me. Jack was brought into the president's office. The article was put down, and he was told, we know you're the source of this article. What can you tell us? And his jaw dropped. He wouldn't say a thing. So he was fired immediately. He was taken to his office. The computer forensics person took the company laptop computer. We took hard drives from he had a desktop computer. And over the next couple of weeks, as we got the information back, what we found out was that this person had been contacted by the competitor in South Africa because word in the marketplace got out that he was not necessarily satisfied with his job working for the company in Streetsboro. And they developed him as a mole. Over the course, it was so over the top. I mean, they flew him to South Africa. He just, as far as the company knew, he was just on vacation. He actually took the digital phone, camera that he used for the company business, and he took like hundreds of pictures from the company to the South Africans. Over the course of time, he emailed them pricing, our European pricing, engineering drawings, everything. And then, the month before this was revealed, the top three management people from this competitor in South Africa came in. He met them at the airport. He brought them in and toured them in our plant. And the last one, what he told, and this is all in emails. I mean, the reason we know this is because it's spelled out in emails. It's just unbelievable. They were joking about it. To the last one, they said, if any of these employees, like the machine operators, ask who you are, we'll just say you're a customer from Australia, because they're not going to know the difference between an Australian or a South African accent. And these guys really don't pay attention to it. They actually met him at trade shows. They were joking about how secretly they would have to meet off to the side. This went on for several months before it came out. Well, it was so over the top, from my perspective, that we contacted the FBI. And we had a contact at the FBI. But initially, when we sat down, the FBI was thinking, this is just between two competitors. This is before the Defend Trade Secrets Act. But after about an hour meeting with the FBI agent, he was convinced this is really something. Because, and I was surprised to learn this, at the time, China was number one, still is, on misappropriation of trade secrets of American businesses, which, by the way, is in the supposedly billions and billions of dollars. Number two,
Russia's catching up, though.
Yeah. Number two at the time, though, was, to my surprise, South Africa. So South Africa was actually on the FBI's radar screen for misappropriation of trade secrets. And to shorten the story, we filed a civil action in the Portage County Common Pleas Court because the former employee who we fired was named the defendant, as were the South African, the individual managers who showed up, and the company, and the local company. And so we had it in state court, which was, we figured, the last place these competitors would want to be. They would never come to the United States. We got a court order shutting down the business before it even opened. Meanwhile, as I got evidence, I fed it to the FBI agent who fed it to the U.S. Attorney's Office. And the South Africans knew that they were under investigation. We were getting ready for trial, and we ended up settling the case, even though we had stopped them from opening, and even though they had our European pricing and other information. We had no evidence of any lost sales. So we had the only damages we suffered actually were the payroll to this dishonest employee, the disloyal employee. But what ended up happening, and I'll shorten the story even more, they paid seven figures to settle the case. They've never reappeared in the United States. they were indicted. The company and the former employee were indicted. The former employee was indicted for theft of trade secrets under the Economic Espionage Act, because that's been around since 1996 and it's a criminal statute. He was convicted, and the South African company was convicted, and they had to pay, I think it was $250,000 fine, which they paid. So, and this was a trade secrets case. I mean, it was the highest level of trade secrets. The president of the company, when this came out, he's a very emotional person, was, you know, felt like he'd been raped. I mean, that they had snuck into his house and just taken this information, and it was a very stressful time for the company. They actually, you know, the settlement turned out to be a good settlement, and the permanent injunction we got against this competitor was something they were able to wield actually internationally. So, but there are many, many other stories associated with that case, but that to me is the essence. So it was all about trade secrets. And they attacked our trade secrets. The defense suggested that we hadn't taken reasonable measures to protect the secrecy of the information. The company is doing more now than it did then. They did have documents, engineering drawings, did have a confidential legend on them, so they were marked confidential. But they didn't have non-compete agreements. They didn't have employment agreements. They could have done a lot more. Long story short was, though, that because the defendants had gone so far over the top, there was no way that they were going to let themselves have a judgment rendered against them by citizens of Portage County. You can imagine what that would have done, which is why when we negotiated a settlement, they ended up agreeing to pay, and they did pay seven figures. So it was kind of a phenomenal, amazing case, and there was a criminal aspect to it, too. Is there a question?
Yes. Yeah.
I have not recommended recording it. You're talking about like the business lines?
Yeah.
Because, you know, I have not recommended that. I think you've got to give your employees some leeway, and you've got to, if they know they're being recorded all the time, and today it'd be even more complicated because so many people have cell phones.
Yeah.
So it'd be probably very difficult to do. There are, on the other hand, and Ron and I had this case where we were on the other side. Our clients have been sued for misappropriating trade secrets. And when we questioned the president of the company, the owner of the company, about the information, our clients engaged in pretty serious inappropriate conduct before they left and sabotaging systems at their then now former employer. But when asked, what measures did you take to protect the secrecy of this information, his answer was, I hired people I trusted. He had no non-compete agreements, no employment agreements. Nothing was marked as or designated as confidential. There was no handbook that said we have proprietary information. Nothing at all had been done. And the court found that there were no trade secrets involved in this case because the plaintiff company had no evidence of any affirmative measures. That certainly this information, which included some long customer lists and contact information, would have qualified as a trade secret very easily if they had done something to maintain the secrecy of the information. The doors locked at night when they left the building, but that was about the extent of it. So that just wasn't enough. And in that case, there were no non-compete agreements. Our client was a group of employees, more than half of it. It's a small company in a very specialized industry. They left sort of under cloak of darkness and formed and set up in competition. And the way they went about doing it, as I said, they sabotaged some computer systems. But this company, had they known, had any idea, I'm sure now they've done things to put in place measures to protect what they consider to be their proprietary information. Yep.
Peter, out of curiosity, what happened to the guy that was committed the criminal act? What happened to him? Did he get jail time?
He got house arrest. He had to pay a fine. House arrest, and he was basically barred from the industry for life. As part of his sentence, he agreed to that. So he was mid-50s. He'd been doing it. He knew the industry. It was a pretty specialized, it was what are called hydraulic gear pumps. So there are not that many companies that manufacture those. They're used like, a, you know, if you see a waste management truck where it's lifting up, it supplies the power to lift the beds, and it's got all kinds of other applications. But that's what he knew. That's what the guy had been doing for 20-some years. And he actually ended up in bankruptcy, too, because his lawyer who represented him basically took everything he had to defend him.
You know, when the gentleman asked the question about recording landlines, and yeah, I think you have to really strike a balance between protecting your company's proprietary information and giving your employees some sense of privacy. It's always a balancing test. But I will tell you, in the case that Peter and I had, one thing that we realized is, although we didn't have recorded landlines or any recorded phone information, we nowadays, so much information is transmitted electronically through emails and texts. And what we had in our case is there was such a record of the acts that our employees did forensically, even though they thought they deleted it. When Peter and I have joked about this, that a computer is one of the best witnesses there is, because it doesn't lie and it doesn't die. It's there. And what the other side actually hired this computer forensics expert that was able to determine when our employees downloaded information, what the serial number of the jump drive was that they put it on. We actually got a discovery request in this case to return. It was a list of, I don't know, a 24 jump drives with serial numbers. We were kind of amazed that that detail of information is available. If you don't think it's there, it's there. And sophisticated computer forensics experts can find it. So, you know, even though, just to finish the thought, even though you might not record the landlines, if there's any emails, texts, any type of electronically transmitted information, there probably is a trail. Go ahead.
Yeah, so you say that people are using laptops versus desktops on some corporations. As far as the access to some personal laptops that they need, the company, what is the user protection for the employee in that situation? And what if they say, oh, I can have rid of that laptop?
Well, and this is where a lot of times it's important in your employment documents to establish who actually owns that laptop. I think it might be more difficult if the employee brought a laptop to the business, but if the employer furnished that laptop, paid for it, you can establish that information, the actual the hardware, the component, is company property, and so is the information on there. We have a policy in our emails that they're not private. We have the right, and we have, we don't make a practice of it, but if there is a problem, we can access people's email communications. Whether they're on their laptop or their phone, it's company property.
It's a really good question, too, about delete, or you know, I don't have that laptop anymore. We've heard that before. And the question then becomes, you ask, put them under oath, well, what happened to it? The hard drive crashed, or whatever they, you know, they'll make up something, they'll tell you whatever they're going to tell you. And so there's what's known as spoliation of evidence. So sometimes the circumstances are pretty clear that somebody just decided to destroy, or they're not going to produce it. We have gotten orders which allowed us to go into private residences and access, I've had my computer, IT people, access hard drives of a former employee's home computer and do a download, which is a real intrusion, as you can imagine. But they left, and there's strange circumstances, so we were able to do that. The other thing that I've seen several times is a person who is, the day before they leave and go to work and maybe for the competition, they've gone on their laptop, the company computer, and they've deleted all kinds of information, or so they thought. And when asked why, well, I thought just for the next person who's going to use a computer, why should that all be there? Well, we have successfully had IT experts recover what had been deleted, and we've had a few cases where what was deleted was just devastating evidence of improper activity.
So even to this day, I mean, when you, there, and now we have text messages, there's so many voicemail messages, those are, you leave a voicemail message, that's on a computer, that's computerized. So to this day, people still don't realize, and they have a comfort level with these electronic communications, which is both good and bad, depends on which side you're on. But you know, certain information is, I always caution people, be very careful. Before you hit send on an email, you should feel comfortable that that email will show up on whatever publication, right. It's going to show, it's there. So don't hit send on an email. I would say the same with text messages. I mean, I'm talking to somebody now, and I've told him the only place you should feel comfortable really is maybe on a park bench talking to somebody, but make sure that, but assume that that person's wired. And assume that you're being recorded. And I hate to, it's just from experience, this level of paranoia, but I have had people where we were investigating, I've had people wired go into meetings to gather information. So I know because we've done it that I caution the people I'm advising to be very cautious. And it just amazes me sometimes when we learn about, we see what people are doing and they're not thinking about these things. And the things they say and the things they put in emails and the way they say them, because I have had emails blown up and put in front of juries. And, you know, I have the person who composed that email and I'll go through it and say, Mr. So-and-so, when you did that yourself. You did it, what, in your kitchen? You did it. No one had a gun to your head. No one told you what you did that. Those are your words. So good luck trying to talk your way around those. So, yes. Well, the Portage County case worked out great. So in retrospect, they weren't hurt by not having done more. But they should have in their handbook, they should have made, where each employee signed acknowledging receipt of the handbook, they should have made clear we have very confidential proprietary information that we consider to be trade secret, that includes our manufacturing processes, some of our special equipment used in manufacturing. It includes our customer lists, our vendor lists. It would be, I'd like to see a specific, and they've got that now. They weren't going to get non-compete agreements signed by most people. They could ask for that. The premises themselves, there's physical security. So they didn't have a system where people would have to like scan in or have ID badges. That's a good idea. Physical security, because one of the things the defense said was that you could actually, from the street with a telephoto, you could look in the summertime, there was a door open and you could actually see into my client's manufacturing area. And you really couldn't see much detail, but this is how desperate they were. They were saying, it's open, you could see, and they had a picture and you could see, you could kind of see what was inside, but you couldn't see the detail that when they came in and the managing director of the company, a month before we caught them, took like 60 photos of close-ups of special honing devices and jigs and things like that that they didn't have. And he actually, in his email, when he sent them back to the other two, he was commenting at how this old company, it's been around since the 60s, how could they, you know, it's a filthy place, he said, but he was trashing the place, but he was commenting at what amazing equipment they had and special devices. So, but back to your question, so physical security, making sure that all visitors are logged in, that kind of thing. Yes?
So at the beginning, I think you mentioned something about reverse engineering. And I think you said that it's legally okay to do that. And
yes.
If someone gets your invention, they reverse engineer it, develop their own, and start selling it.
Right. Yeah, I mean, that's, if there's a patent, that's not okay.
Right.
But trade secret, the trade secrets I've had typically are like a manufacturing process. So you can reverse engineer the product, but not the manufacture, not the process that made it. So, you know, you can take dimensions, engineers, and of course over in China, they're phenomenal at reverse engineering. And then problem over there is that they're pirating and they're designating, you know, something as Titleist golf equipment or whatever it might happen to be when it's not. That's a different issue.
On the line of protection, I've got a two-part question. Number one, if we're a small business, what if every single employee has to have access to trade secrets for us to run? And number two is trade secrets to contractors or non-employees, would that be a revoke?
To the first question, if you're a small business and everybody has to have access to all the same information, so be it. Just do what you can to protect it. Make sure that everybody knows that you're a small company, so they're going to have access, but you know, they're going to have access to information that is highly proprietary, confidential, and not to be released. You may have them sign non-disclosure agreements acknowledging that. So, sometimes that's just the way it's got to be.
And I think in your situation where it's a small company and everybody is on a need-to-know basis, it's more important to keep it inside the company. Again, since there's so much electronically stored information now, a lot of the cases talk about password protection. And if you're going to password protect, don't have the password taped onto the monitor on the computer. There's cases that say that isn't. Don't have a list of all the passwords that is in the lunchroom. There's cases that really talk about those things. One thing, because we alluded to it, we're getting close. Probably
there was a second question.
I'm sorry,
about contractor.
Independent contractors, 1099. You know, if they have to have access to it, is that a deal breaker for trade secrets?
You should have your independent contractors, if they have access to that information, they should sign non-disclosure agreements.
So it's still possible.
Oh, sure.
Absolutely. Right. The one case, just and ending up here, because Peter alluded to it. In the case that we had, that we've talked a little bit about, there was an allegation that our client stole pricing lists, because there was an allegation that every one of our prices was exactly 5% below their prices. And one of the arguments that we made was that, well, he never took the price list, he memorized it. He knew what the prices were. He actually established the prices when he left the company. But the Supreme Court of Ohio has said, because it was an unresolved issue, is that just because you commit pricing or customer list to memory, that can still be a trade secret. It's a little bit problematic practically, because you can give the list back. You can't just delete somebody's memory. But if you can show that they derived that particular information and it's in their head, you still can enjoin somebody from using that information that's in their head. And that case actually went up to the Supreme Court because there was a conflict in a Franklin County case and a Cuyahoga County case, which some of you probably know the parties in that case. We actually now have done some work for one of the parties in that case, but didn't represent them at the time. That kind of was struggling with that balance of, you know, what's in your head is in your head. You really can't do anything about it. But they said that the protection of trade secrets, it shouldn't matter whether it's written down and you actually took a piece of paper or it's in your head. So it's an interesting issue, but that's the law.
So we hope we've given you something to think about. Think about your trade secrets. Be vigilant. Protect them. Thanks for joining us. And I think there was one question here. That...
Yeah, I'm going to make a general statement, and I think that's absolutely true. Most great secret information and confidential information leads companies to casual conversation, and it can be done in, I would say, most cases while people aren't aware that they're doing it. And I was associated with a company that was absolutely been focused on that. Virtually every month, you would hear the chairman of the company in a conversation telling these people, telling the top executives first, virtually every general conversation presentation involved that. Like, if you're sitting next to somebody on an airplane, shut up.
I think that's, I don't know that I'd say absolutely that's true, but I think that's oftentimes the case. There's a case in preparing this, there's a case where a company alleged misappropriation of customer lists, and the defense that ultimately prevailed was, well, you used to have parties where all your clients would be invited and everybody would come, so everybody knew who your customers were. It was in the public domain, and that was successful. So yeah, if you really think it's a trade secret, keep it secret.
Speaking of casual talk that you've mentioned, trade shows are just replete with casual talk. I mean, there's so much that develops and comes out of trade shows. And if you're smart, you would really extremely caution your employees to be very careful. Don't get too relaxed and comfortable, because there's a lot of economic espionage. There's actually an entity called the SCIP. It used to be Society for Competitive Intelligence Professionals. But there are big companies are big on competitive intelligence and how to go about gathering on your competition intelligence. It's kind of like private espionage, but they do it so that it's legal. But it's, you know, the more information you can get on the competition, and if you could get inside information that's legitimate on the competition, more power to you, because it's going to give you the advantage. So again, thank you all for joining us, and hope to see you at the next breakfast briefing.